not a presentation.
There you go.
I like that move.
You ready?
Mm-hmm.
Hey! Welcome to the second Coffee with Kay. I'm so excited today. Our topic is faith and fertility, and we've got some incredible women who have struggled with but overcome infertility. Their pathways to parenthood were very different, and I'm going to let them share their own stories, but I'd like to introduce my fabulous guests. First, we have Mrs. Phyllis Von Traeger.
Hello, everyone.
And I'm going to let her share a little bit about herself. And then right here in the middle, we have Mrs. Hope Fields.
Hi.
Hey. And then you know who I am, Camille Hammond, CEO of the Kay Foundation. So without any further ado, what's in your cup? Let's get started, ladies. What's in your cup?
My cup is coffee, but it's decaf.
Very good. Well, it's 6:30, so
yes,
you know, I'm old.
Mm-hmm.
No, you're not. Oh, please, not old. Okay, and?
And I have hot chocolate because I want something sweet.
Yummy. I love them both. I have been a coffee addict for a long time, and I have recently kicked the habit. So, yeah,
I'm impressed. I did,
but I backslid today. I had a cup of decaf. Mm. But it was delicious. So, I'm working on it, but coffee is still my friend and one of my favorite beverages. Anyway, so today our topic is faith and fertility. Why is that important? Ladies, tell me a little bit about why this topic resonated with you.
I think for me and through my journey of infertility, I grew in my faith.
Yes.
And that got stronger for me, and I turned to God, and my relationship with God grew as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because of having the, you know, infertility issues with my first daughter. And I felt like I was praying to him all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Throughout the whole process. And every time I felt at ease, I felt calm, and I did get frustrated at times because, you know, you want to get pregnant and you want to have that baby, and then, you know, you have to go through this step and this step and this step. So the process of becoming pregnant with Sophie really turned me to God and allowed me to pray more.
Mm-hmm.
And which has, you know, she's 6 now, so mm-hmm. my relationship with God has definitely strengthened. I'm more in the Word.
Mm-hmm.
I focus more on the Word for my day-to-day, like everything that I do.
Mm-hmm.
And in my work, my social life, my marriage, my kids.
Mm-hmm.
I'd really try to put that at the forefront.
Okay, okay. And Phyllis?
For me, it would have been a different journey.
Mm-hmm.
So faith was hard, having faith during infertility treatments, losing triplets, and it was a hard journey. But I think for me, what I recognized is when I couldn't pray, others were praying for me. So surrounding myself with people who had strong faith, when I felt like I couldn't, I turned to God a lot, but there was a lot of anger at times.
Yes.
Because it wasn't how I thought it would ever be.
Well, I want to talk a little bit about that. So, you know, in church, a lot of times we talk about the fruit of the Lord,
mm-hmm.
God's bounty. And I think a lot of times people think about having children as a manifestation, kind of like an outward manifestation. So I know that when I struggled with infertility, I felt really convicted. I felt really like, okay, I'm not getting pregnant. What have I done? Like, is God punishing me? You know, have I not kind of measured up? And it was hard a lot of times. I don't know if you guys experienced anything like that, but, you know, I know that it took some time to kind of, for me to get through my own emotions. Can you, did you experience any of that?
I had a slightly different, because I knew I had like irregular menstrual cycles.
Okay.
So I knew going in that it was going to be some type of issue.
Okay.
I would need some type of intervention.
Okay.
Just to get that rolling.
Moving. Okay.
So
okay.
We tried without, you know, any fertility help. My gynecologist was like, you know, let's just, you know, get off the birth control. Let's just try it and see what happens. And, you know, I prayed and prayed 2 months. I didn't get a period. I knew I wasn't. And I know, but she wanted to try it anyway. So then that's when she sent me to Fertility Center of Maryland in Towson.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay. Well, that's,
yeah. Wow. For me, I think I remember feeling like I wasn't, something was wrong with me. And the verse, Psalms 139, where it talks about being fearfully and wonderfully made. And I was like, God, this part of me is not fearfully and wonderfully made. Why is this journey happening? Uh-huh. Why, I'm a teacher. I love children. Kenton and I love kids. This was what happens next.
Uh-huh.
So I think through that, faith to me, when I think about that whole process, is it's in those deserts, it's in that pain that I found God in a very different way. And it wasn't just when I got the miracle of my child, Ian,
mm-hmm.
when we adopted him. It was totally and utterly finding God in the midst of pain. And I think pain and joy go hand in hand.
Now, I want to kind of dig into that a little bit, because Phyllis, you're a PK, right?
Yes.
You're a preacher's kid.
Yes.
And so, kind of coming up from that background of being raised in a household where the focus was God 24/7,
yes.
pretty much since birth, right?
Yes, yes.
How was that treated in the community?
So I think one of the things that I will say is I was pretty open about our journey.
Mm-hmm.
I did it with Kenton to talk about it. Can I share this? So I think one of the things that happened is because I shared it in our church community, in the people that I was closest with, that helped me be open in the church. But one of the flip sides of that is you often get the answer, well, you know, if you adopt, you will get pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
Or you often hear, you just got to pray more.
Mm-hmm.
So I think in my head it feels like you can go right back in that moment, correct? Because
mm-hmm.
you can feel that intensity of it at times for me. No matter how many years it was, it's still a part of who I am in my journey.
Mm-hmm.
But I think one of the things is, I always called them bubbles. In church when I'd go, I'd have bubbles when people would say things that were meant to be really kind, but were most hurtful.
Mm-hmm.
And there were days that I chose not to go to church. Mother's Day was one of them.
Mm-hmm.
Mother's Day was one of them where that was totally and utterly, I didn't want to ruin it for others that were joyful in being a mom, but
uh-huh.
I knew that that was a yearning in my heart so much I couldn't embrace that.
Uh-huh.
So I think church is a great place to find your support when you're open,
uh-huh.
but I also think it's a painful place because you become surrounded by people that it's family. Like,
mm-hmm.
you are, and everybody has kids. Our churches are very focused on the children.
That's a very interesting perspective. Now, you are one of a large family.
Yes, I'm one of 12.
Okay. So, did you feel like in your home or in your, you know, kind of your small community growing up, I guess it was a big community, one of 12.
Yeah, my immediate family is like its own little town.
Wow. That's awesome.
We're all together,
yeah.
Yes, yes.
That's awesome. But how did you feel when, I know that you kind of thought, okay, this may be an issue.
Yeah.
But when it actually was an issue, you know, how did your family react, or did you feel supported, and, you know, how did you deal with that?
I think, you know, when I knew I had to go to fertility, I was okay with talking about it and explaining the process.
Okay.
A lot of you know, of my family and some of my friends said, oh, you know, it's just going to, you know, get you jump started. It's just going to, you know, get things working. Mm-hmm. And I was like, yeah, you know, and the doctors there told me that, you know, what I received Sophie through IUI, and they said, you know, you may have to do this a few times. So they kind of prepared me for it possibly not working the first time. But my family and friends, I talked to my one sister Jennifer and my closest friend Kelly a lot about it through the whole process, because mm-hmm. most of my appointments were in the morning, mm-hmm. and I'll be driving to them, and so I will be talking to one of them mm-hmm. about what I'm about to do. So that was comforting for me, mm-hmm. Being able to talk to them about it and explain the process, because all my sisters that have kids, I have one that did adopt as well, they had them fairly easy.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it was hard for them to grapple that side of it,
okay.
because it was easy for them. But mm-hmm. they, you know, they listened and they supported me, and they were happy when, you know, I became pregnant.
Right, right, right. Yes, that's so I love the fact that you are two women who had really different experiences, mm-hmm. but the thing that connects you both and why it's important to hear both of your experiences are you still both overcame. Mm-hmm. You know, you both got the support that you need, you needed, and you're here today, you're both moms, beautiful kids, two lovely girls, adorable girls, and one handsome young man, strapping young man. Right, he's like
6'3".
Yeah, wow. But you're here, and, you know, so many people just wonder, will I overcome? And I think the beauty in seeing both of you, you know, we got Canada right here. Canada in the house.
Oh, Canada.
Oh, Canada, preacher's kid. Yeah. And then we got Baltimore in the house, you know, Howard County, you know, from just completely different backgrounds. But you're still moms, and I think that the message that I get from that is, regardless to who you are, regardless to what your background is, if your faith is important to you, you know, you don't have to feel like God has abandoned you.
Yes.
If it's an easy journey, that's right. Beautiful. But if it's harder, and, you know, for me personally, it was really hard. I didn't know anybody who had infertility. I didn't know anybody who actually wasn't trying to prevent pregnancy. At least I thought I didn't.
Yeah.
Everybody I knew was like trying to avoid being pregnant. So, you know, we were so down low in the closet. I mean, nobody knew we were trying to get pregnant. And then when they kind of figured out after a couple of years, you know, and hearing little things, they started like making us godparents. I don't want your baby. I want my own.
Yeah,
I remember
right.
thinking that. Right. I remember. It was all in love. But, mm-hmm. you know, I'm still a mom today, too. Mm-hmm. You know? So God was faithful.
Yeah.
And we've all been blessed.
Absolutely.
In different ways.
Yeah.
So, Angel, I want to give a shout out to our incredible intern, Angel, who
Yay.
Is manning the phone and iPad. Do we have any questions? Okay. All right. Well, we're going to continue. So tell me something now. Why are you all willing to share your story? Because so many people are scared that if they share that they struggle with infertility, that somehow they'll be rejected. A lot of people are afraid to acknowledge that this was an issue. Why were you all willing to share?
It's a part of me. It's my life.
Mm-hmm.
It's a part of my life journey.
Mm-hmm.
It's the way God created me, I like to put it. He created me that way, and he planned for me to go this route to have Sophie.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have to go this route to have Mackenzie. 9 months later, but
thankfully,
yes. And but I felt like everything happened for a reason, and I feel like why not share that part of me
mm-hmm.
when it was such a blessing.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
I think one of the reasons why I feel compelled to share is because I think to tell people that it's a journey, and in looking back, I embraced it the best that I knew how,
mm-hmm.
And I felt like, and feel like, God took me through everything, even when I couldn't see it,
mm-hmm.
and to never give up the hope. It may not come in the package
right.
that you think,
mm-hmm.
or you feel you deserve, or it is what you imagined,
mm-hmm.
but it's the package for you, and it's the and my package, my child. I wanted what we recognized in going through infertility treatments, losing triplets, and then taking some time. We recognized what is most important.
Sorry about that.
It is that we wanted to be parents. That was most important.
Mm-hmm.
So God was going to give us what we our heart's deepest desire. It just took a longer time than we ever fathomed. But 16 years later, it's very well worth the wait.
Amen.
So the question that you raised that I think a lot of people have to really look at is, do I want to be a parent
mm-hmm.
or do I want to have a pregnancy? And that's
yes.
not a question everybody has to think of, but that is a very important question that
Absolutely.
Many have to reconcile, because they're not necessarily the same thing.
Mm, that's right.
Mm-hmm.
Very true.
Yeah, and as someone who has 3 beautiful kids but who's never been pregnant,
mm-hmm.
it's a question that I personally had to struggle through, and then decide I'm okay with not being pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not okay with everyone.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you have to get to the point where you're good with, you know, whatever you and your husband have come to and y'all prayed about, and
mm-hmm.
you know, you feel a sense of peace with, you know, you gotta to do that. So what, if you had to share, what was the most impactful experience on your pathway to parenthood that you would like to share with someone? Because, you know, you're talking to me right here, but you have the whole internet, and this will be up on our Facebook and Instagram pages and also on our website. So before it's all over, there are thousands of people who are going to see your testimony. And they're looking for some kernel of hope, something that says, please don't give up. So what can you share that, you know, was impactful for you and hopefully will be impactful? You know, we have one question really quick. Think about that. Let that marinate. What's the question, Angel?
How do you know adoption is the next step God wants you to take?
Okay.
So for us, it was, Kenton and I went through the treatments and we got pregnant and I miscarried the triplets at different times through a pregnancy. Not very far along, but they were different times. One of the things that Kenton and I promised each other was that we would know when it's time to end.
Mm-hmm.
So we went through the treatments. And we prayed about it. We had friends pray about it. And it was very clear, this is time. So we had a service of remembrance
mm-hmm.
and letting go. And we had it at our church. Then we promised each other we took a year off.
Wait. Can you tell me, what is the service of remembrance?
So we had a time where we had friends share. We had verses shared. We prayed for the babies that I had lost, because we wanted to honor that,
mm-hmm.
because that was the first time I had ever heard I was pregnant. And we also wanted our community to recognize we were ending this, mm-hmm. and it's time to move forward. Mm-hmm. So please pray with us next. What is to come next? So in that year, and we promised each other 1 year away from everything. And in that year, we had an inquiry about adoption. Somebody contacted us. We were not ready. We didn't even believe that that was going to happen. But that got us started, and then we discerned through that year what was the most important. And how do I know if God wants you to adopt or not? The biggest one that I would say to you is you've got to decide, you and your husband, do I want to be a parent? And if so, is this the best way? And I will tell you, we got Ian 6 days after he was born. He is ours. All ours.
100%.
Yeah.
He doesn't look like us.
But why
he is
our,
well, he is so handsome and
multi-facial. You guys are pretty sharp.
Yeah, but he doesn't, but it was truly embracing. And you, again, surround yourself with a community that's going to pray with you. Mm-hmm. And you find a peace. And I found a peace, and so did Kenton. Mm-hmm. And we found it at the same time.
That's good. Hope. I think that's a nice segue to what was your most impactful, because it sounds like that was a period,
yeah.
that was a point of, okay, the path has changed, and
mm-hmm.
you were both in agreement.
Mm-hmm.
Hope, what was your thing that kind of stood out for you?
I think once me and my husband knew we were going to do the IUI, and even for him, it was different for him. Like, he was still, you know, very not knowing what all this was. Like, it was, you know, we were both learning at the same time. So I think I prayed tremendously that, you know, this would be the first, it would work the first time,
mm-hmm.
and that I wouldn't have to go through it multiple times. Because it is a lot on the body. And my husband was a great support. He really, you know, helped with the injections and all that. And so I think that was the most part, just like when it feels like you want to stop and just
mm-hmm.
say, I don't want to do this to my body. I don't want to do this anymore.
Yeah.
It's not there. Just please pray
mm-hmm.
and pray.
That's
and talk
right.
to God and just explain how you're feeling and talk about how you're feeling. Because it really does help.
Mm-hmm.
It just kind of calms you. And, you know, he's listening, you know, he, you know, can't say anything back to make you feel like, right. So,
yeah.
you know, you're just talking,
yeah.
and you just, you know, just stay with it and just pray and find that support system, as Phyllis said, and just, you know, go to them and talk
yeah.
it through if you need to, but don't ever feel like you need to stop and it's not fair and I just don't want to do this to my body anymore, but because, you know, some things are not always going to be as easy as you would hope.
Mm-hmm.
I think one of the things that is a thread for both of us is community.
Mm-hmm.
So if I, like for you, you were in, quote, the infertility closet is what I call it,
oh,
because it's
yes.
always like that coming out
you
later, but it's
deep
that infertility.
In
yeah. So I'm going to surround myself. And there are moments and there are people that can do that. But if you have one or two really good friends or family members, whoever that is, that community is going to be the testament for you. And that community is going to be helpful as you go through that.
So what you're saying is come out of the closet?
In whatever feels comfortable.
Yeah.
Like for some people, it's a whole community. Oh, I'm infertile. And they
yeah.
just say
it,
right?
Very, yeah.
And there were moments that I did that.
Mm-hmm.
There were moments when I felt like I needed to protect myself
mm-hmm.
because I couldn't share it with everyone in the same way.
Yeah,
and
I agree.
There was some deep pain that I knew that we needed just that small circle.
Yes.
But I do think it's important to have the people to keep you grounded.
So when we went through infertility treatment, I did feel like we were the only ones. And most of our friends and family found out, frankly, when we were on Good Morning America. I mean, you know, when my mom had the triplets, anybody who's watching that doesn't know, my mom was my gestational carrier. She delivered my triplets when she was 55 years old. So we had two media crews that came to the hospital, and they did two interviews, which each took maybe 2 minutes each. And that 4 minutes, let's give it 10 minutes to be generous, was cannibalized and cut and split to the point where we were on all of the morning television shows. Pretty much every news outlet had covered us, although I hadn't spoken with any national news people. But I had good friends who, you know, I had like recently had dinner with that were calling me at the hospital like, did you forget to mention something? You guys were getting ready to have a baby. And by the way, we're going through fertility treatment as well.
Yeah.
So that's what I found out. The perception was that we were alone, that we were the only one. Mm-hmm. But the reality was we're almost bumping into our friends at the fertility clinic.
Yep.
Everybody was struggling.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
But
yeah.
None of us were talking about it.
Right. No.
So we were in our own little closets, which were right next to each other. And that's one reason why my husband, Jason, who's the co-founder of Kate Foundation, and I decided to move forward and start an organization, because we didn't need to struggle alone.
Yeah.
Right.
We could have had friends and family and colleagues walking alongside us, because they were walking alongside us. You know, we could have been supporting each other.
Yeah.
And so we started CAIDS, hopefully to be able to provide that opportunity so people didn't have to walk alone, because this can be really lonely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think isolation creates loneliness.
Anxiety.
And anxiety and depression.
Mm-hmm.
At times. And again, you don't have to be an extroverted person and just blurt it out. You can choose the way you want to. But again, sharing your journey is, you will find thousands of people. And when you're getting the 6 o'clock blood drawn,
mm-hmm. absolutely, mm-hmm.
you're on the same cycle as 16 other people in the room.
Right.
And you all walk mm-hmm. in and you're all...
Right. I'm going to pretend like I don't
a
see
pin
you.
Drop.
See you. And then slowly I was like, how are you doing? You know, I'm Phyllis, by the way. This is my husband, Kenton, because he came every time. Yeah. Yes. Thank God, because I'm not the morning person. He drove me.
Well, we could probably continue this conversation for a long, long time, but... alas, our time is up. So I'm going to end by thanking Phyllis and Hope for coming out, for sharing their stories.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you. This is wonderful.
And I encourage everyone to not give up on your faith, your family, your future. You're all overcomers as long as you just don't give up. And on that, I want to make sure you're all aware there is a faith-based support group that meets at First Baptist Church of Glen Arden. Which is in Glen Arden, Maryland, right outside of Washington, D.C. It's called the Abraham's Promise Ministry, and I believe they meet monthly. And so if you have any questions, please follow up with First Baptist Church of Glen Arden with the Abraham's Promise Ministry. And the two women over that are Wanda Thomas and Keely Walston. And so that's if you're interested in a faith-based in-person support group. And there is lots of support also online. Fertility for Color Girls is another group that meets. I think their closest place is D.C. But Resolve, the National Infertility Association, also has in-person support group meetings. So don't be afraid to reach out to some of these resources if you want to meet in person. And then there are so many fantastic online-based supports. So you don't have to walk this journey by yourself. Anyway, have a great night. What's in your cup? Coffee.
Hot cocoa.
Water. You guys have a good night. See you soon. Take care.